Good morning. This is Dr. Sindhu. Diabetes is a disease that separates the warriors from the rest. There are no days off from it. And at its best, it's manageable. And at worst, it's the greatest weight and discouragement that can be felt. Today, a topic of discussion is about high sugars, which everybody knows and calls as diabetes. And today, we have a doctor here with us who will be discussing about how our diet, how our sleep, and how our bowel habits affects diabetes. And also we will be discussing with him regarding how diabetes affects various organs in the body, which includes eyes, kidneys, heart, brain, and nerves. India is the diabetes capital of the world, and it is coupled with certain lifestyle changes. And it's also a major concern and challenge for the healthcare profession in the coming decades. Please enlighten about it, doctor.
Thank you, doctor, for talking about a very important topic today, which everyone is aware of these days, which is the high sugar levels in our body. The high sugar levels, also commonly known as diabetes, comes in various different forms. We are actually seeing an increased incidence of diabetes in young children, in adolescents, and of course in the older age group as well. So if we actually look at why these sugar levels are high, then we have to go back and look at what we are doing wrong. What we are doing wrong as a society, what we are doing wrong as individuals. For a start, nobody gets up in the morning and goes out for a walk. Exercise component of it, the sun exposure component of it is very limited in today's population. If you look at vitamin D as a drug, it is one of the most powerful vitamins which helps in reducing the incidence of diabetes, which people are unaware of, which you can actually get it for free if you get up in the morning and go for a walk or do some exercise in the sun. So our habits have shifted from not being able to getting up in the morning and going out for a walk, not able to do, your bowel movements are affected, your bowel movements, a lot of people are constipated these days, leading to blockages in the system and unable to excrete the waste out of the system. There are a lot of issues, the lifestyle issues range from not eating the right kind of foods, not sleeping on time, unhealthy snacking at mid meal snack is a huge favorite, and the snacking is also unhealthy because people eat a lot of refined foods, which increases the sugar level to very high levels. Basically, the high sugar levels is actually an epidemic is of epidemic proportions. What we see in India right now, right across the age groups, because of the complete food habits and the lifestyle habits. The food habits being eating the wrong kind of food, eating at the wrong time, eating at way past your bedtime, midnight snacking, and all those kind of things. And maybe the exercise component of it, the sleep component of it, also not being done properly. So all these factors lead to an abnormal increase of diabetes in this country. Stress also plays a very major role, and stress is again very closely related to not being able to sleep properly, which causes a disruption in the melatonin levels. And again, when they are not able to sleep properly, their morning cortisol level and even there is a diurnal variation of the cortisol throughout the day, but the morning cortisol level increases, leading to an increased sugar response in the body. So these are all the causes in the modern day lifestyle. It is a lifestyle disease. Diabetes is a lifestyle disease, and the modern day living habits has made it worse for a lot of people. Awareness is setting in. A lot of people are now getting to know how to manage this better. A lot of people post COVID are able to try and relate to more naturopathic form of living. They're able to live relate to more healthy eating habits. So they are actually aware of how to try and manage the disease themselves, because they tried to do that. They learned to do that during the COVID period. So they are now aware and they want to do it better going in. So the community is getting to know how to eat better, how to think better, how to sleep better, how to get better without medications. And of course, we are able to help them in this regard. You know?
Thank you, sir. So all these actually leads to insulin sensitivity.
Yeah, see, what happens with diabetes, it is called insulin resistance. Insulin resistance is a big problem. All the cells in the body are constantly bathed in a huge sea of glucose. Now, the glucose needs to get into the cells, and when the glucose is there, it triggers a response by the pancreas, which secretes the hormone insulin. Now, the insulin is supposed to be the key which opens the door to the cells, the muscle cells, the liver cells, and the fat cells, for the insulin to get inside the cells to do whatever it's supposed to do. Either it gets stored or it gets used up as energy. For various lifestyle reasons and genetic reasons, the cells are not as responsive to insulin. So when the food is digested and is broken down to glucose and hits the blood, the pancreas does secrete the insulin, but the insulin is not effective, or it doesn't work as appropriately as it should work, leading to a high insulin levels, which is called hyperinsulinemia. There is this condition, and as long as the pancreas is capable of producing these insulin levels, the insulin levels keep on rising, and it tries to push the sugar levels, sugar molecules, into the cells, which it succeeds in doing. So there is a point in time where your body has got high insulin levels, but your sugar levels are normal, because the sugar levels have been managed to push into the cells by the high insulin levels. This is the condition before pre-diabetes kicks in. And this stage in that person's life can vary from a few weeks to a few months to sometimes even few years. So it is important to actually ask your doctor to check for the fasting and postprandial insulin levels, which will give a good indicator of where you are going. If you have normal sugar levels, it does not mean that there is no risk of getting diabetes in the future. You can actually preempt that by doing a fasting insulin test or a postprandial insulin test and see if you're hyperinsulinemic, which is also a risk factor for diabetes in the future. So this hyperinsulinemia or leading to insulin resistance is now a well-documented factor in a lot of polycystic ovarian diseases, in metabolic syndrome, in different types of diabetes, and it's also implicated in other autoimmune diseases as well.
Thank you, sir. And what is the right methodology to investigate these blood sugars?
Now, traditionally, if you look at diabetes per se, it used to be investigated by urine sugars, which is a fallacy in itself, because the sugar in the urine happens a lot after the blood sugar level rises. Then they moved on to checking fasting venous sugar levels, which we still do. They moved on to checking HbA1c, the average sugar. HbA1c is an average reading of a 3-month. It's called a glycosylated hemoglobin. So it gives you an average of the sugar reading in the body over the last 3 months. So they have been, these are the various common modalities of checking which has been present till now. Of late, there are advanced modalities to check your sugar, such as ambulatory blood sugar monitoring and continuous blood sugar monitoring. Now, the advantages of doing this ambulatory blood sugar monitoring, wherein you put a small receptor on your skin for 14 days and it reads your sugars for the entire length of 14 days, is that it gives you a better value of understanding, because your sugars need to be within a narrow range, which actually God has designed your body in such a way that the sugars always fluctuate within a narrow range. But in insulin resistance, which means in diabetes mellitus and other conditions, the body has lost the ability to regulate the sugar within that narrow range. So it goes up, and then it goes down, and when it goes up is when you are actually taking your tablets, and then the tablets actually fail to keep it within the narrow range. Sometimes it pushes us even down. So the hypoglycemia is actually more dangerous and difficult to identify and manage than the high sugars, and it's also more dangerous. The low sugars is also more dangerous. So when we use the newer modalities of measuring glucose, such as the ambulatory glucose, ambulatory blood glucose, and the continuous blood glucose monitoring, we are in a better position to understand where the sugar value fluctuates during the day. And our target is to try and maintain them around 75%. It's called time in range, TIR. So the TIR should be around 75% of the time we aim to maintain the sugar within that normal range. So the sugar, from checking the sugar in the urine to doing a continuous monitoring over a few days, that is how the sugar has evolved. So today you are doing, even in the future, you may ask, how is it going to look in the future?
Yes, that was my next question actually. Yeah. So how do you foresee the future of this methodology?
See, today we are using HbA1c as a very common modality of checking sugars. Now, HbA1c gives us a sugar reading over the past 3 months. Based on the sugars which have been present 3 months or 4 months ago, we are making changes to the current medication. Do you think it's a bit old-fashioned, old standard? So, but that is what is being done across everywhere. Probably because the HbA1c is easier to do and it's a blood test, and it's been a fairly good indicator so far. And in most of the studies and papers published, that is actually taken as an indicator till now. Now, going forward, I personally feel that there are advanced modalities like this ambulatory blood sugar monitoring will be the norm, and calculating the time in range will be the norm. Checking for your fasting insulin or insulin levels, fasting or postprandial insulin levels, and getting the insulin levels also in a range will be looked at very closely by the future, so that management of this chronic condition becomes much easier. So when you are using the ambulatory blood sugar control, you actually are able to see the readings every third day or fourth day. You see the readings, you see the fluctuation of the readings, you see the insulin responsiveness of the patient, and then you make the adjustments to the time, adjustments to the medication, either change the medication or adjust the time of the medication. And in real time, in 3 days or 4 days, you see the changes which is made. Now, the other added advantage of using this modality to check sugar levels are, you actually see which foods aggravate the sugar levels, increase the sugar levels in certain patients. Not all foods act the same in all the patients. Now, some people tolerate rice very well. Some people actually don't tolerate quinoa very well, although quinoa is actually promised to be a low glycemic index. And certain types of millets also are tolerated very well. You know, to find out which is your ideal food type also, you can use this kind of sugar monitoring. The only downside I see as of now is the price of these things and the ability of the patient to come back and take a report. Now, that is also sort of overcome with the smartphones these days. Your sugar levels can be read using a smartphone at home, and the report can be downloaded and sent to your doctor. The only element is the cost, which will, I think, in time with the advancement of technology will be overcome, and it will be hopefully available as less as an HbA1c cost is today.
Yes, sir. But anyway, we will be having an individualized care for the patient as well with this technology, I think.
Yes, it will be a personalized, individualized care for the diabetic patients, which will help them to identify which food suit their we talk about today genetics, epigenetic testing, and all those things. So this test will help moving in the direction, it will help us to identify what food suits you, what is the right medicine. Which there are genetic tests in cancers which people do, which tells which is the drug which is most suitable for this kind of cancer. So this test also will help you identify which drug is working the best for you. If you're using that monitor and monitoring your sugars in real time, and you don't need to do this forever, you probably need a 14-day window or a 28-day window. Within a month, you will be able to gather all this information and data, and you can utilize that information and data to help yourself and your doctor to establish the best treatment plan for you going forward.
Sir, can you elaborate a bit more about oxidative stress?
Yes, oxidative stress is another major factor in diabetes which we need to really discuss about. You know, there is this process called oxidation by which the food molecules are converted into energy. So in the process of oxidation, some of the atoms lose their electrons. When they lose their electrons, they become free radicals. Now, free radicals we know are damaging to the cells and the organs and in and around wherever they are functioning. Because these atoms lose their electrons and become free radicals, by default, by nature, they try to pick up electrons from the neighboring atoms. In doing so, they create more free radicals. Sometimes the oxygen also becomes free radicals, which is called reactive oxygen species. Now, this reactive oxygen species has the ability to induce damage to the DNA, the protein, and lipids. So, the only way to combat these free radicals is to have antioxidants in your body, antioxidants in your system. Most of the time, the antioxidants can be taken in your system with the help of foods. A lot of berries, all types of berries, nuts, and all the good foods, the broccolis and veg, everything contains a lot of good antioxidants. Actually, there is a score called ORAC score. The oxygen radical absorption capacity score, ORAC score, is actually, it gives the total antioxidant capacity of the food. So certain things like, you know, sorghum, millets, and your turmeric and all these berries, they have a very high ORAC score. Whereas again, when you come to the meat and other things, that they are very low in ORAC score. So if you eat a lot of these high ORAC score foods, which are in general good foods, your antioxidant ability of the body to combat with the free radical release is maintained. So oxidative stress, coming back to your question regarding oxidative stress, it is a condition where the free radicals overpower the antioxidant capacity of the body, either in a food form or a tablet form, whatever you're taking, that overpowers and that causes damage to the end organs. Now, the most common damage it causes is the endothelial damage. So the endothelial damage to the eyes cause your diabetic retinopathy and cataract formation. Endothelial damage to your nerves in your peripheries, in your hands and feet cause the typical diabetic neuropathy, which they call they complain of tingling and numbness in their fingers. And the same endothelial damage to the heart causes myocardial infarction, and the same thing in the brain causes stroke. So, and in the kidneys, again, the endothelial damage to the blood vessels causes diabetic neuropathy and a protein leak. So the oxidative stress is responsible for all the complications we see in diabetic in various organs. So it also does not help in any way elevation of the disease. So we have to really, in order to reduce the complications of diabetes, we have to maintain the oxidative stress at a very low level or no oxidative stresses at all.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for giving us a clear overview about diabetes today. And for more updates and information and discussion with doctor, you can book your appointment and have your consultation done. Thank you.